Der Lawinenlagebericht.
The avalanche bulletin is the basis for planning for all ski tours and freeriders. And the avalanche bulletin, also known as an avalanche report or avalanche forecast, you have all the relevant information together in one place. That means it's ideal for me to extract information about the conditions, namely the snowpack structure and the snow and avalanche situation from. In Europe, and in Europe it predominantly the Association of the European Avalanche Warning Services, the decision was made to ensure that communication about avalanche danger is uniform. You use a five-level scale in the five avalanche problems.
If you go to the European Avalanche Warning Services website, you can see the danger level map on the very first page. From this danger level map, you can get to the country you're planning to visit, and then you can see straight away that all of the avalanche warning services work the same way. First, this overview of the danger level. That means you can see straight away, is it favorable? Is it very dangerous? So you already have a good, rough initial overview. And then you come to the respective avalanche bulletins, or avalanche report, and these are always structured exactly the same way. After the danger level come the avalanche problems. And now for each of the avalanche problems, we take a look at where the problem is, what elevation, what slope aspect, and then comes the text portion. The blog assessment of the avalanche danger, snowpack structure. And anyone who wants more information can go further into detail.
The information in the avalanche bulletin is displayed in the form of an information pyramid. At the top is the avalanche danger level. This gives a general statement on how dangerous the forecast in the chosen region is. The compass rows and the elevation are also often provided for the avalanche-prone locations where the danger is especially high. The avalanche problem tells us the characteristics of the danger on the slope, so how pronounced the danger on the slope is. On the next level, we find the information about the snowpack and the weather. There, more experienced users can find more detailed information about the current avalanche situation. Of the five danger levels, the first four levels, 1 to 4, are important for winter athletes. When it gets to level 5, very high, we usually won't even be able to reach the skiing area because the road is closed or perhaps because a disaster has occurred. At level 1, low, avalanches are unlikely. Avalanches rarely occur at this level. Level 2, moderate, means that human-triggered avalanches are possible in the forecast region. Level 3, considerable, means that human-triggered avalanches are typical. This means that on a good weather day, when there are a lot of people out in the forecast region, you must expect an avalanche to be triggered, or even several. At level 4, high, spontaneous avalanches are typical. This means avalanches can occur without human intervention.
The determination of the avalanche danger level is based on snowpack stability, probability of avalanche release, the size of the avalanche, and the distribution of dangerous areas in the mountains within a region. And at level 1, dangerous areas are very isolated. And it could be that I have the bad luck to cross this dangerous area at level 1 and trigger an avalanche. On the other hand, of course, the following situation. At danger level 4, it is much more likely that I have this dangerous area somewhere in the mountains, and it could be that I am extremely lucky and manage not to trigger an avalanche. That means an avalanche can be triggered at any danger level, and that's why level 1 is low danger and not no avalanche danger. The second level of the information pyramid indicates where we have a problem, and here we use pictograms. And among these pictograms, on the one side, we have here the pictogram for slope aspect, the direction the slope faces. So we can ask, on which slope aspects do we have our problem? And also the pictogram with the elevation. At what elevation? Above a certain elevation? Below a certain elevation? Or within a certain elevation range, for example? Yes, the avalanche warning services have now now agreed to attach these pictograms directly to the pictograms showing the avalanche problems. This means that you have even more detailed information. Where do I have what problem? And that supports the course of action I take in the mountains. For the avalanche warning services, it is always important to indicate what the problem is. And that's why these European avalanche warning services all agreed to use five very typical pictograms for these five avalanche problems.
The International Avalanche Warning Services have agreed on five avalanche problems. These are wet snow, gliding snow, new snow, wind-drifted snow, and persistent weak layers. The new snow problem describes a new snow situation. As the name suggests, the danger is presented by the snow that has fallen in the last few days, or perhaps the snow that is currently falling. The concept of the critical amount of new snow helps us estimate how severe the local danger is. And here there are four values you should look at. The first is the amount. How much snow has fallen? How much snow is there in front of the cabin door? The second is, how high is the temperature outside? If it is very cold, it is often more critical. How much wind was there when the snow fell? And on what surface did it fall? What type of snow surface was the old snow surface that this new snow is lying on? When it comes to the wind-drifted snow problem, the main factor is wind. People say that the wind is the architect of avalanches. It whirls the snow up in the air, and the snow makes its way to the ground somewhere else and is deposited there. And depending on the direction the wind is blowing and how strongly it is blowing, it can form bigger or smaller snowdrifts on various slopes. Fresh snowdrifts are predominantly susceptible to stress while the snow is being deposited, meaning when the wind is still blowing or shortly afterward. And then a single winter athlete could potentially stress the snowpack and trigger an avalanche. The persistent weak layer problem is more of a hidden problem. It can't really be linked to the weather. Often this situation occurs on days with calm weather. Perhaps it has already been sunny for a few days, and the problem here is really a weak layer that is located within the snowpack and is susceptible to stress. It can't really be explained by the wind or changes in temperature or new snow. One of the typical weak layers in the European Alps is faceted crystals. These are present in around 3 to 4 of all avalanche accidents. Other weak layers include buried surface ore and depth ore. Sometimes faceted crystals are called cup-shaped crystals. When it comes to the wet snow problem, the main factor is water in the snowpack, and water can be released in the snowpack when the snowpack melts. Due to temperature increase, sunshine, or high external temperatures, or if, for example, it rains on the snowpack, this water permeates the snowpack, and when this water accumulates or enters a weak layer, it can cause a weakness and trigger an avalanche. These are generally spontaneous avalanches. In a gliding snow problem, the snowpack glides down toward the valley on a film of water. The areas in which this danger is prevalent can often be identified by the cracks in the snowpack. These situations arise in late winter, but also in early winter. The water can be created by the snow melting within the snowpack when there are high external temperatures, but also in early winter when the ground is still warm and the snowpack is insulating the ground. Often, several avalanche problems will be indicated if the situations overlap. For example, new snow and wind-drifted snow if there was a strong wind when the new snow fell. In the avalanche bulletin, we can also find a block of text. The danger description will summarize almost all of the information about the current danger. There we can find the stability, the distribution of dangerous areas, and also the size of the expected avalanches. Who can trigger avalanches? How frequently can they be expected? And you will also find a recommendation on what course of action to take in the mountains. At the base of the information pyramid, we have the snowpack and weather section. This often requires a few clicks before it can be found in the avalanche bulletin. There, we can find information about the details, about the local assessment in individual regions, or maybe even about the reason behind the formation of a certain avalanche situation.
Nowadays, there are are also aids that you can use to write down the most important information from the avalanche bulletins in a structured format. And then you can use this cheat sheet when you're out in the mountains and check what you need to look out for in the area you are currently in.
Even modern avalanche warning services have to address certain conditions. Our assessment is based on an area covering 10 by 10 kilometers. That's 100 square kilometers. What we can't do is assess an individual slope. That's why you have to observe and think for yourself, then it will work.
Finally, it is of course important that you make good use of the avalanche bulletin when out in the mountains, and that depends on the users. Beginners will concentrate more on the danger level and avalanche problems. With this information, they will act more defensively in the mountains than advanced users. With the additional information from the avalanche bulletin, advanced users will see and identify significantly more out in the mountains and be able to act accordingly, and they can, therefore, get about more safely.
Avalanche bulletin is the most important element of planning a tour. We summarize all of the information and are thus equipped for a day touring in the mountains. By adding our own observations in the mountains, we bring the information up to date so that we can make the right decisions on the slopes.